next speaker is Michael Schlossler. Sorry. He's going to speak on elliptic extensions and look theory.
Okay, thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this wonderful conference, which brings together all people from different areas, number theory. This will be a more combinatorial talk, but the connections are U-series and hypergeometric series. This very much has to do also with the spirit of Aladi, who maybe in collaboration also with George Andrews and influenced by him, has given combinatorial proofs to many U-series identities. And in this case, we will look at not at Q-weights, but at elliptic weight functions and give combinatorial meaning to identities involving such elliptic weights. Originally, I wanted to just focus on Rook theory, but I think I want to, because it's a broad conference, motivate a bit more and to bring things into a broader context. So the one question which arises is why elliptic? Why to go to elliptic? Why to stop there? So this is, somehow I want to motivate this by explaining a natural root or also natural hierarchy of identities or weighted identities going from rational to elliptic, like of counting, normal counting, Q counting, elliptic counting. As a motivation, that's where I actually started to consider elliptic weights. That's where it worked. That was one area where the framework of providing elliptic weights actually led to nice results with elliptic enumeration of lattice paths, so that I want to recall. And then, in joint work with Nissung Yu, a postdoc from South Korea, we actually found that in Rook theory, which I will briefly review, that provides such a meaningful extension where one can give attribute elliptic weights to the certain Rook placements on the board. It's a little bit more complicated there. The Rooks on the cells of the board, they have different weights, as exposed in the Q case, where they all have the same weight Q. And this will be then elliptic Rook theory. So we will show you some nice identities there. Okay, so just there's one slide of maybe complicated formulas at the moment to start with, so that we know what to talk about. So elliptic functions, in the sense I'm using it, will be expressed in terms of ratios of theta functions. And I'm using this modified theta function. So you can, it's theta x with known p, it's this intimate product, 1 minus x minus p, x and so on. Can be also written as a infinite product, or in this case a p infinite product, and then 1 minus p over x minus p square over x and so on. So this, of course, the third product would be missing, then you can identify this as Packer's from the Jacobi's triple product identity. I'm also using this condensed notation for products of theta functions. And of course, p should be less than 1. But the problem is I couldn't let x go to 0 in this expression because I have the whole of infinite order. But this, more or less, and that's like one way to view it, this extends, so if we have quotients of such products, a linear factor, 1 minus x, which appears in rational functions. So if p is 0, then most factors just drop out, and we have just left with one term, namely 1 minus x. So this is, can be regarded as a p extension of this linear factor. This is to keep in mind for the combinatorics later. Then these modified theta functions are easily seen to satisfy some kind of inversion formula. If you replace x by 1 over x, you have a similar expression. If you shift x by p, this is now multiplicative shift. It's called quasi-periodicity. So it's convenient to write this in this multiplicative way. Of course, Jacobi's triple product identity has also sum side as a bilateral sum, but I'm using this product form for convenience. So these two, so these are two fundamental identities, and due to Weierstrass, which is not so well known, but it appeared, for instance, in Alpkin's talk yesterday, I believe, or the day before, there is this three-term relation, product of four theta functions minus another product of four theta functions equals, again, a product of four theta functions. And that will be very fundamental, on one hand, in the theory of elliptic hypergeometric series, and also doing combinatorics with this. So everywhere where one applies induction or functional equations, things can be maybe split apart using this addition formula, and then regrouped together again doing that. Okay. And note that there are four theta functions, four variables x, y, u, and v in a certain order. Okay. So now I want to do combinatorics. So I want to count. So that's like how one starts to do mathematics. And so one is counting, one is adding, one is noting that one can split n into parts, let's say n and n minus n. So that's one way to do that. That's the ordinary case. It's well known to you. Now, for those who are affected by the Q disease, they very much know this identity. Also, the Q number of n, which is defined n in brackets, so Q is 1 minus Q to the n over 1 minus Q, plus, and now you have the shift involved, the Q to the n, so you can probably, it already depends on the location of the elements in the shift, and you continue a little bit later. That's why you have the shift times n minus n equals n. And of course, n, we just call the Q number of n, and Q to the n, the Q weight of n. So what do we mean here? So it's already some kind of combinatorial interpretation. So you have lattice parts starting from 0, 0 to 1, n minus 1, and you, this is that n sub Q is the Q number of n is the area generating function. So you can either go, you can go steps east or north. So either you go, if you go up to 1, n minus 1, you take the first step to the right and then up. So it gets weight 1. You just count the weight, the area below the path. Or you have one step up and then to the right, so Q or Q square and so on. So you have an indefinite summation that's very important, which is summable into closed form. So indefinite summations play an important role. And also, now I want to modify the weight so that I still have maybe a closed form for the expression, for the not Q number of n, but maybe like an A Q number or a B Q number or whatever. In our case, elliptic number, which will then also have extra parameters. So the important thing also is that if you have, in principle, an addition formula, if you want to have an addition formula involving shifts, so kind of recursion, and you're looking for meromorphic solutions, I'm not explaining the whole setup, but then you have either rational trigonometric, which corresponds to Q, or elliptic at most. Nothing beyond that. So that's also a way of some kind of explanation why I come to elliptic. To add numbers on the real line is easy. N plus N, you just, in school, you just add, it's like adding vectors on the real line. To add trigonometric functions, you do that on the circle. And with elliptic numbers on the elliptic curve, so that's also somehow a motivation. Why elliptic? So let's go here. This is already a extension of the Q number. So here the Q weights are as follows. So we can just have the weights in the different cells. So I explained what W1, 2, 3, and so on are. So I would put these weights in here instead of just Q everywhere, different weights at different levels. And if I sum up that, I get this AQ number of N. That's very nice. So that could be also considered a well-poised analog. You will see it later. We will then have such special terms appearing in the expression. If A goes to infinity, you recover the Q case, which you can see. And if A goes to zero, the 1 over Q instead of Q case. So now the second, the B extension, would be like a balanced extension. So on the top of well poised, you will see later what I mean about by that here, like a balanced extension. your theory of an extra parameter B, and also things work nicely. So this addition formula, which you have here, works nicely. So you have n, you can add n and n minus n with an extra weight, you get m. So we want to do combinatorics now with suitable weights, depending on the location of the objects. Yeah, that's the idea as I mentioned. And here, if B goes to zero, we recover the U case, as you easily see. Now these two can be unified, so with the AB extension, so that's balanced and very well, and well poised, so even very well poised. If you know what well poised means, you will maybe see the structure. And here, just want to mention this 1 minus AQ to the 1 plus 2N, that's like this very well poised term, which you maybe are familiar with if you're know about Q hypergeometric series. So I'm considering such weights. So this is on the rational level. Now it's easy to extend this to the elliptic level by replacing linear factors by infinite products, like by data functions. So that's what is done here. That's the next case. So if I consider this W as a weight on the different cells, and I want to compute the generating function, it adds up to the from 0, 0 to 1, n minus 1 to this elliptic analog of n. Simplified indefinite by definite summation, by itself telescoping arguments. It works nicely. So that's what that was one way how I came to this, by knowing that indefinite summation exists. So Olli Vaaranen had revealed this in an early paper on elliptic hypergeometric series. And knowing about this, I was able then to extend Q weights to elliptic weights using this. So now you see you have a very nice, still a closed form expression. So that's more or less one kind of motivation. So of course, now I want to give you a little bit of background, more like a talk about hypergeometric series, and then I want to give you combinatorial models where this can be used. So it's not trivial that, or it's not granted that you will find suitable models where this can be all used, because many things may not be simply extendable to this elliptic setting. Of course, by having more variables, you again, not everything extends. That's clear. So what is you consider a series, which term CK, and the ratio of consecutive terms we call G of K, CK plus 1 over CK. Then it's well known that GK is a rational function of K, S is called hypergeometric. If it's a rational function of Q to the K, it's called Q hypergeometric. And now G of K is an elliptic function of K. And this is now what I mean by elliptic, if it's meromorphic and doubly periodic, then S is called an elliptic hypergeometric function. Yeah? And of course, and by the theory of elliptic functions, or delta functions, abelian functions, it's clear that how the terms then look like, they are actually ratios or products of delta functions to a constant. And now it makes sense to define an elliptic shifted factorial, or actually a delta shifted factorial, because this is actually delta and not elliptic. Just quotients, suitable quotients would be elliptic. I will not really need this much here, but I'm just noting that this extends the Q-shifted factorial. So we have A, Q, P, K, A, semicolon, Q, P, so K, this product of K factors, theta functions. And, it's well known here, this is now about special functions, that hypergeometric series have a rich history. They already appeared in work of Newton, binomial series, Gauss, who studied the 2F1, or monotron, I should mention, who should also be mentioned, like Newton, who also gave many identities. And, Q hypergeometric series, Euler, work of petitions, and an extended work of Gauss, and of course also from monotron and other people. Elliptic hypergeometric series came very late into the game. They were They appeared implicitly in work of statistical physicists, Japanese authors, 1987. But Frankl and Clark were the first to have explicit solutions in terms of the elliptic hypergeometric series, the solutions of the Young-Baxter equations that they were interested in. So again, the Young-Baxter equation has rational solutions, trigonometric, and elliptic, if you're interested in aeromorphic solutions, and then maybe others as well. So this is now a fundamental theorem, the theorem of elliptic hypergeometric series, just to give you an idea what this is about. Here is Franklin Charles 10V9 summation. And it extends, and it, you can see already this verbal voice factor which I mentioned in the beginning, delta of AQ to the 2K appearing there. That's, but okay. For P equals 0, it extends Jackson's 87 summation, which again is a theorem log of Dougal's 7x6 summation. And this is a very fundamental theory, theorem, this identity, the theory of elliptic hypergeometric series. So if you take n equals 1, you just have two terms, the k equals 0 term and the k equals 1 term. And the right-hand side is just the product. So you have a three-term relation, which you can rewrite and identify as this addition formula by Erschwitz, which is sometimes referred to as a Riemann relation. Because Riemann studied addition formulas and similar relations in general, but not this particular one, which is due to Erschwitz. So now I want to show you how one can do combinatorics with elliptic weights. So of course, I mentioned lattice paths, but just going one step to the right at most, one can extend this to going as many steps to the right as one wishes. So one starts at some starting point u, kl, and goes up to v, let's say, nm, and is considering, again, weights only on the horizontal steps. The vertical steps would have weight 1, and the lattice path, so assign the weight to wnm if it ends in point nm, such a single step. The weight of the path is a product of its weights. And I want to attach this elliptic weight now, WST, which depends on AB, to independent parameters, then the norm P, and also the base Q here. Notice that if many things go to zero and so on, so first P, then A, then B, then you just have the Q to the T left, which is usually the height of the step. One can define in general, for any weights, a binomial coefficient, a weight-dependent binomial coefficient, by considering the generating function of all paths from 0, 0 to k, n minus k. And, of course, by this combinatorial interpretation, it's clear that if you have, if you just go up always, so there's, we said that's weight 1 always, this expression n to 0 would be 1, and if an n choose k is 0 if it's out of range. So if k is negative or k is greater than 1, n. And of course, you have immediately a recursion for these binomial coefficients. You're looking at the last step, which is either vertical or horizontal. And now, for the elliptic weights, you have a nice product form that's nice. So also, recursion works by using a Erschwitz addition formula for data functions. And you can also shift things. So not only would you start with 0, 0, but if you start at some point LK, go up to NN, then you also have a closed form, which is not, that was actually the difficult thing to get, because that's not so here. You cannot just use an indefinite summation, you need things to work at the, And you see that it's more involved. So if L and K are zero, both, then a lot of factors here drop out. And you have also interesting some terms which depend maybe on 2n minus 2l, so are quite large products in a way. But what one even immediately can obtain, and for instance, this is like also one picture proof. I want to derive the Planck derived summation. This will be a convolution of binomial coefficients, something like the Pandemont convolution for binomial coefficients. So we have those forms for the generating function of class from 0, 0 to nm, from 0, 0 to lk minus l, and from lk minus l to nm, of course. We know, can just plug in this explicit formula everywhere. If we do that, here, noting that any path from 0, 0 to nm has to cross a given diagonal, then we can enumerate, we have immediately this convolution of binomial coefficients. This factor on the right-hand side, this corresponds to the, sorry, I don't know if it's very important, but more or less to this weight, which is here. So if you count this weight here, and you have to shift things, you have additional weights. Like in the case, you have to
add sometimes
extra something in addition. So you immediately get that. And by applying analytic continuation to variables which, so not to k in this case, but to n and m, we can recover the full Planck interlaced summation from here. So now I want to still, yeah, now I'm going to Brook theory. I want to define the following factorial, which is in Grund's notation, z to the n sub bar of n or underlined n, just for compact notation. Then Hallett's way to define the Q-following factorial, so not the way it's defined in Q-special functions usually, but using now the Q-numbers. So z Q n following would be z, the Q-number of z, and z minus 1, and Q-number of that is up to down to z minus n plus 1.
Yeah.
That's also, that's a, in combinatorics, it's a nice way to define Q-following factorials. In the elliptic case, it's similar, but now we have the additional shifts of some of the parameters. So for each factor, each next factor shifted, the A is shifted by Q squared and the B by Q. That's how things then work nicely. So there, I'm not stating it here, recursions for these elliptic factorials. And so they satisfy identities. So Rook theory was introduced, classical Rook theory by Kaplansky and Rorden in 1946. Rorden considered it further. I will be interested in a finite, okay, we are, in general, the setup is when it's considering a finite subset of, okay, we have n columns, that's just for technical reasons, but I'm considering any more, and infinitely many rows, possibly, but in, since we've considered finite subsets, we could restrict that to any given square region or whatever. But anyway, and the point is that we consider subsets. That's now indicated in the shaded groups as a subset. We put groups on this subset, on this board. The board is a subset, such they don't attack each other. By attacking means that they cover, they dominate all the cells which are to the right, to the top, to the left, and so on. So the same row. Nothing should be in the same row or same color. Even jumping over things which are not in the subset. Yeah? So all the same coordinates should be shared. Okay. And now the question is, how many ways is it possible to place k non-attacking groups in B? That would be the kth Rook number. And of course, we have a set of k Rook placements. So this would be a 3 Rook placement on this particular unusual board. The number, as I mentioned, would be the kth Rook number. And we will actually only consider particular boards, a skyline board, which is bottom justified, and then we have certain heights. So this will be interesting for the file numbers and the Q and the elliptic extension of that. And this is a Ferris board now. So one can consider this as a the right bottom corner of justified, and then we have like a, let's say, lattice path going from 0, 0 to this endpoint here. That would be the shape of that, or that would determine the border of this board. So this will be important, and Gordon, Trichet, and White, 1975, they gave a nice formula for rook, involving rook numbers on Ferrer's boards. So the Ferrer's board B1 to Bn, these are the heights of the columns here. So B1 is 0, then B1, B2 is 2, 3, 4, and so on. So these are the different heights. And if you expand this product on the left, touch the different BIs, you get, and in terms of the polyfactorials, C to the K poly, you get the N minus K root numbers coefficient. That's a very nice result, which in general don't need to factorize in closed form. In some cases they do, and in some cases they have nice combinatorial interpretation. They get different Stirling numbers or La numbers, for instance, in another case, in the La numbers they factorize. Or other numbers, yeah. Yeah, the proof, which the standard proof uses, that one attaches other rows below the board and one placing roots there as well. That proof actually extends to the Q case and to the Lüttke case. That was just one mention. But I don't want to go into technical details. I just want to give you impression what has been done. And so here is now the Q case, Q root numbers. So again, this is just for Ferrer's boards. You have this board, the shaded region. You place in this case four roots on this board. And now you have the roots again, they attack the whole, everything which is in the same column or row, but they cancel. This is now a different term, only those cells which are strictly below or strictly to the right. So this rook cancels this two cells, this rook cancels everything to the right, there's nothing below this here, and that rook on top cancels everything below. So these are all cancelled cells. And the other rook, other cells are non-cancelled cells. And we're interested in the Q weight here would be Q to the number of uncancelled cells. In this case, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Q to the sixth would be the weight here. In the, if Q goes to 1, we just count this as one rook placement allowed. But this is a refined counting, so this is Q to the sixth. And in general, so this is UB of P, the number of parameters itself, so Q to the UB would be the weight. And with respect to this counting, you give, yes, so you have a, it's here what the rook, Q rook number is, so you have to enumerate all rook placements by this Q counting. And now you can, sorry, you expand. And this is why we're interested in this Khalid's type of falling factorials and rising factorials. It appears in this formula, for instance. You expand the product on the left side in terms of the basis on the right hand side. It's not immediate, maybe, to the, to know that this is a basis actually and what is the space, but it works out. This can be also done by induction. So, and that the coefficients would be independent of Z, that is also maybe not a priori clear, but it, yeah. That would be something technical. So, file numbers I will maybe drop now that they are related to skyline boards. They're actually much simpler. But also, Cassier and Remlin unpublished work gave or studied this, and we were really aware of this factorization theorem. And this is called the factorization theorem, group theory. And it was later published by Remlin and Briggs, I believe, that appeared on explicitly. So now I want to assign elliptic weights to the different cells on the board. So it's much more involved. So these are my weights now. You recognize them maybe again. And so these are the big weights, the W. They would correspond to the column weight. And here's the small weights, the small W's. They are really the weights of the cells. So it's actually better to think of the weights of different cells, which one is then multiplying together to get the full weight of a rook placement, or of a rook configuration. And again, the, as I mentioned, the product the weight of a rook configuration is the product of the weights. which are not cancelled by any root SMT, so we again apply the same root cancellation, almost the same, but we have to shift, we have to of course take care of the location of the cells, and which is quite non-trivial, we have to take care of how many roots are northwest located. That is a certain technical thing, because we want actually the columns which we are taking product of, they wouldn't be else contain consecutive weights. So dropping out those columns, which so that we can really group weights together, things will work nice. That's just a technical thing which somehow comes up if one looks at small cases and then one can prove that this works. Again, all these weights would be just Q in the Q case. And then we, so Misu-Yu and myself, we prove this factorization theorem. So we expand a certain product of n elliptic numbers, or APQP numbers, in terms of z to the k following. And the coefficient is exactly the n minus k elliptic Hook number. We have similar results for file numbers, for matching numbers, related to shifted boards, augmented boards, and various kind of extensions. As applications, we get elliptic extensions of special numbers, for instance, of Stirling numbers of the second kind, of the first kind, Lie numbers of Auger numbers, which would count trees, certain trees, restricted versions of that by chopping off certain columns in the board, generalized versions, like PQ versions, also elliptic extensions of that, you know, augmented boards, which more or less have extra factors in addition, so yeah, more complicated matchings, as I mentioned. We can also consider, on an algebraic level, an elliptic extension of the Weyl algebra, consider normal ordering of that, and the elliptic group numbers appear exactly as coefficients of normalized words in that algebra. So in general, you've seen what I want to congratulate.
Maybe time for one question.
So if you take an example of mode and you allow all the squares, the generating function for the
would be input
probability.
What? Rectangle board.
And all the positions are allowed. You get the generic function becomes a Langevin polynomial. The root polynomial becomes a Langevin.
Okay.
You get any orthogonal polynomials? Any other ones from the general board? Or?
Yeah, we didn't consider yet elliptic orthogonal polynomials. So this is just, you're just.
What about the Q case?
So I know only that. Cassie and Daniel have considered Q Laguerre boards, or Laguerre boards, and.
Right.
Yeah. I was not sure if they did it. I think root theory and orthogonal polynomials have been studied by Gordman, I believe, and. But I have not studied this, on this context yet. But this is also kind of invitation for elliptic common boards, so that maybe we can connect it even more to other fields. Yeah?
I'm
going to
have
to
ask. Is there any chance for elliptic?
Yes, there are. One can. Petitions are plain or Young tableau, one can have from the coral weights, and if it's restricted, it will get those points. That has been done by implicitly in my work on non-intersecting lattice paths, and explicitly by grains, foramen grains, in some in appendix of one of the papers.
So we're going going to start immediately.